Welcome to Relaunch Sunday. Come on. Jesus. Come on, you lift it up. Gather together, something can happen. Amen. And so there's power when we're together. Amen, church. This morning we came just to worship God for all that he's done through something that may have been so confusing. And so I don't know about you, but I'm just grateful that through this, he gave me a new heart for church. He gave me a new heart for people. He gave me a new heart for community. I don't know about y'all, but I'm super grateful that he gave us each other. Amen. And so I don't want to ever take it for granted, but we're going to worship this morning. I hope you're ready. You know, it's a beautiful thing when you can approach God and tell him that, God, I'm available for you. And maybe you've never asked God or told God that you want to be used by him, but this morning we want to give you that opportunity to, you know what, say, God, I've seen what you can do. I want to be a part of it. You may be thinking, I'm not gifted, I'm not talented, I can't do anything for God, I can't give anything back to God. But the beautiful thing about being available for Jesus is that he can do whatever he wants through you. It doesn't have to be with what you think you have or what you think you don't have. It all has to do with what he has and who he is and who he's called you to be. He calls you by your name. He knows who you are. But this morning, we need to be available for him to use us. I love it. Jesus is always moving. Don't ever doubt it. He's always moving, but it's up to us to be available for him to move in us. So don't ever doubt that God's not moving this morning, because he is, I promise. In your row, in your heart, in your home, in your lives. But the truth of it is we need to say, God, I'm available for you. Are you ready to say that this morning? Can you say that with me? Say, Jesus, I'm available.
Jesus, I'm available.
Oh,
sacrifice. Ooh, sing it. Use me how you want to, God. Have your throne within my heart, Jesus. I hear you call. I am available. I say yes, Lord. I am available. For me, I tend to hide things that I think God won't be able to use. You know, like, oh, that mistake. Like, try to hide it from God because I don't think He's going to be able to use that. Maybe a choice I made a long time ago. God, I don't think You're going to be able to use that. Maybe a situation that hurt you and left you in a state of just brokenness. Maybe, God, I'm going to hide that because I don't think You're going to be able to use that. But I know a God that can redeem anything. He can use anything. The word says that God will turn everything for His good. So that means when you say, "Here I am," you can have it all. It's not this half-hearted surrender. Half-hearted surrender is not going to get you anywhere, church. It's going to get you stuck in the middle. I'm on this side of the fence and I'm on this side of the fence. You're going to live so confused. God never called you to a half-surrender state of life. He called you to full surrender. But I promise that peace that you say, God can't use it, God can't redeem it, it's not good enough for God. That's the part He really wants to use. I said this on Tuesday, but everyone has a story, and every story is unique to you. We shouldn't compare our testimonies. We shouldn't compare how lost we were to the grand story of how we got found. For me, I was talking about that. I was raised in a home that was raised to believe in God, and I wasn't forced to believe in God, but I was given the opportunity to believe in God. And from a young age, I fully believed in Jesus. And so I don't really have this story of I was so lost and I found God. I really was blessed in the fact that He found me and I stayed found. And that's a beautiful story, but just as much as a story of, whew, I thought I wasn't gonna make it. I thought that no one loved me. I thought that no one cared. My parents didn't want me. School treated me terribly. I was bullied. I didn't think anything was worth living for, but I found God. See, that story is just as special as the other. Because the power of your story is it's yours. God gave it to you. So don't you dare count off what God can do with you, through you, for you. Here I am, you can have it all. This is my thing. I don't want someone missing out on Jesus because I won't surrender everything to God. God's waiting for you. He wants to use you to touch someone's life, but you got to give Him it all. So if you're holding back today, I just want to give you a moment to say, Jesus, I'm so sorry. Will you take it all? Take the guilt that I feel. Take the shame that I feel. God, this thing that I did that I'm holding on to, God, will you take it? Will you use it? Will you use it, God? Because here I am. Here I am. You can have it all. You. Come on, some testimony now. Something in your heart this morning that you just need to give to Him. And maybe you don't, and that's okay, but just spend a moment with Him. Jesus, I'm sorry, Lord, for the way I made it. Use me how you want. Use me how you want to. We're here for you, God. God, I pray that we would just be so in awe of who you are. God, I thank you that you can use our mess to bring a miracle through you, God. Jesus, I thank you for who you've called us to be. You've called us your children. We're children of God. God, right now, I just want to dedicate our lives to you, Jesus. God, use us how you want to. What an honor it is to be used by you, God. God, I pray that you would have your way in every single life represented in this room. Every heart represented in this room, God. God, that you would stir up a passion inside of them, that they would pursue you so hard, so full of just joy and love. God, that you would give us such a new passion for you. God, that we would not search the things around us or the approval of man, but we would come straight to you. Jesus, we just came to lift up your name this morning. as always, God, we give you all the honor, all the glory. In Jesus' name, come on, the church said, amen. Amen. Come on, you can do better than that.
Wow. I'm like, I'm so excited. I want to say welcome to G5. Welcome to the relaunch of church. How many of you are glad to be back in the house of God? Amen. Oh my word, we were talking about it in the team circle. I'm telling you, I'm going to be honest. There's times I took this for granted. I really did, and I heard that alarm go off in the morning and didn't want to get up, and I'm here to tell you right now, I am so grateful for an alarm that got me up this morning for church. So excited. So we want to say welcome to G5. We are so thrilled to be here. We say this, and it's so true, that you can belong before you know how to behave, and it's a thankful thing, and the reason we put that in place is because PT and Mama G are still trying to figure it out. So we figure we got to let everybody know that. But we just want to say welcome. If it's your first time, please welcome. We are so glad you're here. Welcome home. And if it's your second, third, fourth, whatever time, and you're at G5, or welcome home, welcome back. Yes. So one of the things that we do here, and we want to make sure everybody's comfortable with this, if you're not comfortable with somebody giving you a G5 fist pump or even a G5 side hug, that if you just want to go high five in the air, G5.
Give him an elbow.
You do whatever you want. You can do an elbow or whatever you feel comfortable with. I got to go like this because I can't see everybody. These new lights are awesome.
We got new lights, everybody.
New lights. So right now, you guys just kind of look dark. Maybe you got a good tan. So anyway, take a few minutes, get five people somewhere and give them high five or whatever and say, welcome. We say here at G5, not for long, so don't get too comfortable. Some of you are like, whoo, it's about time. No, because we got some more worship to get on. So this is one of my favorite times of the service, and I know we say that a lot, so I hope we never get like, we just hear it and we go, oh, okay, here we go. I know what she's getting ready to do. There's a powerful scripture in Galatians, and I think Miss Laura has it. She's going to put it up, but it says, don't be misled. You cannot mock the justice of God. You will always harvest what you plant. I was like, wow. And can I tell you, I even looked at PT earlier and I said, is that negative? Is that negative for me to say that? Because it says, don't be misled. You cannot be mocked by God. You will always. And you know what it is? No, I want to tell you what it is. For so long, I believe the church has put a negative on this. Oh, you're going, you know, have you ever heard that? You're going to reap what you sow, yeah. Girlfriend, boyfriend, whatever. And so we take it from that. But you know what? This is a privilege. Yeah. It is a privilege to plant. It is a privilege that you're going to reap what you sow, and therefore we get to sow. And I want to tell you, you guys are amazing. You have been phenomenal. You are sowing even in the middle of craziness out there because you know that God's promises don't change. Yeah. Just because there's a pandemic or whatever we want to call it, God's promises don't change, and His word doesn't change, and the privilege to give back to God doesn't change. And we're just so grateful because, as you can see, we now have lights, we have new cameras. You guys, I hope you guys understand, we are now reaching so many more people than we triple the people that we've reached. I got to go like this so I can see your faces. Oh, you're beautiful. Wow. All you should come up here one time and see, because it's like blank. It's awesome. Anyway, hello. So, but I do want to say that God has really put on the pastor's heart that we really are going to reach the north, south, east, and west. And we're this little 62-acre ranch with this beautiful building that God gave us, but we're reaching. We had some people stop us when we were out there working and said, "We just saw you on Facebook, and you're amazing." And I love what she said. She looked at Bree, and she said, "I'm going to tell you something. Your worship is all that and a bag of chips." And I was like, how cool is that? So we'll take it. Our worship is all that and a bag of chips. But we get to give back to God. And I just want to thank you guys for being faithful and knowing that God is doing a mighty work here. And your seed is going into fertile ground. And you are going to see a harvest. And so I want to thank you. So if you guys could stand, we're just going to pray. There's ways that you can give. Oh, there's TVs now. The donate. Okay, so I was getting ready. Those of you that are new, we had a massive white screen that just got taken out. I went, whoop, it's not there. We have these awesome TVs. Also in the back, just so you know, there's a table back there. We will not be passing around the offering baskets so that you all don't touch them all at one time. But we have g5church.com. You can text g5church 77977. Also, there's back here. And my favorite is the app. Just go to the app. I love it. You just go, boop, and you go give, and then you give, and it's awesome. So let's just pray. Everybody's going to do that now. Sorry, Blake. Okay. Father, I got to get myself together. Lord, thank you so much for this opportunity and this privilege. And God, I thank you for the sower. And I pray that, Father, you would bless them. I thank you for what you're doing here at G5. And Lord, you have met so many needs, and you continue to do that through your people. And I thank you for their faithfulness. And we're going to give you the honor and glory for this moment and this time. In your incredible name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Church.
You are.
Favor be upon you in a thousand generations. sing it, amen. Come on.
And
what's so cool about this bridge is that it says, may his favor be upon you and 1,000 generations and your family and your children and your children's children. I don't know if you know this, but G5, we're so passionate. We're so passionate about you, but more than anything, we want your children's children to follow Jesus. We're generational here. But what I love about this is that maybe you have a family member who doesn't follow. Maybe your parents don't believe. Maybe you're scared for your children who've walked away from the church and they're not too sure right now what's going on. Maybe your siblings. Maybe just a close friend. But you know the power of God. I say this, but I truly believe that we're called to fight for people who can't fight for themselves. And what I love about this song is it's a fight song. It's telling the devil, you know what? I believe that God is going to reign forever and ever and ever and ever. He has no place. God has already won. He has the victory. Come on, my children's children will believe in God. My children's children will follow Jesus and serve Jesus and love Jesus and care for Jesus. Come on, this world is not yet lost. Still got it in his hands. But church, we can't be silent. This is not a song to sing, may his favor. No, it's may his favor. Because I believe it. Come on, my kids need this. My family needs this. Oh yeah. So if you're with me today, can we sing it with a little more passion, a little more belief? Can you fight for someone that you believe to be fought for this morning? Come on, we gotta sing this. We gotta sing this in a tone that God knows that we are serious, that we believe in this. May his favor be upon you in 1,000 generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor, may his favor be upon you. Thank you for your favor right now. I thank you for who you are. I thank you for what you represent. God, I thank you for our children's children, that you already know them by name, that you already have something in store for them, God, to do your work and your will. God, I thank you for this generation coming. I believe that they are going to be able to see signs and wonders of Jesus. Come on. That our world is not yet lost. That this generation will stand up. This generation will rise up. And they will call upon the name of Jesus. Amen, Jesus. God, we're here for you. God, we seal this in your name. May your favor be upon us, Jesus. May it follow us wherever we go. But God, this is one thing I ask that you help us with. I pray that you will help us steward the favor that you give us. Don't let us waste it, God, but help us steward it to do your will and your work, Jesus. God, we love you. We believe in you. We thank you for who you are. In Jesus' name, come on, the church. Sit. Come on, give it up for PT. Let's go.
Come on. He's good. Come on, do better than that for Jesus this morning, man. Yeah. Woo. I love it, man. Well, give somebody an air high five and sit down. There you go. Right there it is, right there. Yeah. What a privilege to be with you. It's so great to see you this morning, man. We're so honored that you're here, and all of our online guests from all over the world. We're so pumped you are here. Thank you guys so much. I'm so glad to see you. Look at your neighbor and say, you look way better than I thought you were going to look coming out of this time of being apart. Can you just tell them that? Yeah, man, it's good to see you. I'm so excited to share with you this morning. I'm going to try to throttle back just a little bit so I'm not too passionate, but I'm fired up to be here. Thank you, and what a privilege. We got, when you come to G5, we got so many places to wash your hands. We got hand sanitizer. I'm telling you, I've eaten more hand sanitizer in the last few days than I ever have in my life. I wasn't a big, my wife for years has been into the sanitizer stuff. And I'd be like, but I wash my hands like crazy. But man, it's just a new world. But what a privilege and what an honor. The last few weeks of my life, this scripture in the Old Testament that says, if my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and begin to pray, I'll heal their land. And I'm just asking God to heal our land. Would you agree with me, church? Would you just put your faith together with God right now and say, God, we're just asking you to heal our land. I think he's going to amaze all of us at his power and his wisdom. So this morning, I want to do something very special. My buddy, Junior Correa, I love him so much. His mother passed away, and I want to dedicate this service this morning to his mom. Her name is Haiti, and she's, she's dancing all over heaven right now. But Haiti, we love you. Junior, we got your heart and your back. And boy, she left a great gift on this planet in her son. So what a privilege. But we just want to honor her. Anyhow, I want to talk to you this morning about worry. You know anybody that's ever worried in their life? How many of you have ever worried in your life? You don't have to raise your hand. But if you're sitting beside a worrier, would you just raise your hand? Yeah, I know they're worriers. Some of you were raised in homes where they specialized in it. I mean, your mama, she worried about everything. Your daddy, they worried about anything. Do you know what I'm talking about? And I want to tell you, I'm not being light of worry because worry is real. Can I get an amen in here? I mean, it is amazing how worry attacks us. Have you ever known somebody that was just a worrier? They call them a worry wart. They just worry. And man, if you've ever been around that, or if you've ever found yourself in that place of worry, I'm so glad you've tuned in. I'm so glad you're here today, because I think we're going to make some headway this morning. There's this scripture in Philippians 4, verses 4 through 7. I don't know how much you know about Paul. I love Paul. He persecuted Christians. He actually killed Christians. And one day on the road to Damascus, God strikes him blind and changes his life. And he becomes one of the greatest evangelists in all the Bible. I love that the Bible doesn't try to sugarcoat the stories of men and women who found Christ and followed Christ. Aren't you grateful for that? So he finds himself in prison, and in prison, I don't want to gross you out, but they literally put him in sewage up to his neck to try to get him to shut up talking about Jesus. And in the middle of all of that, Paul writes in Philippians 4, he says this, he's changed a guard. Every 8 hours they would change a guard and they would put him just under constant lockdown. He writes this scripture, rejoice in the Lord always. Now, I don't know about you, that right there, I could just stop. What? What? When they cut me off on I-4, I find a little bit of, it's hard to rejoice. Do you know what I'm talking about? When somebody hurts you, when somebody does something that irritates you, come on, can I get an amen in here? By the way, we are loud here at G5, so don't lose your voice, all right? He says, rejoice in the Lord always, and I say it again, rejoice. Do you think he's serious about rejoicing? Let your gentleness be evident to all. Okay. The Lord is near. We live in a society where we don't want to be gentle. We want to be, look at me. Do you know what I'm talking about? I'm powerful. We even want our God to be powerful, and when he whispers instead of yells, it bothers us. And he says that, the Lord is near. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything. In every situation, but by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the God of peace, which transcends all understanding. Can I just tell you, one of the greatest enemies to faith is reason. I don't understand it, God, so it can't be right. Most of the things that God asked you and I to do, we're not going to understand it. Pray for those who do harm to you. What? Bless those who curse you. What? Give and it shall be given. No, you give and then I'll give. Beep. I'm telling you, it's honest, man. Transcends all your understanding, and he will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Not very long ago, it was a while ago, I was on a plane and Gay didn't go with me. And I sit down, and then this lady comes in and she sits down beside me and she's very well dressed. And I looked over at her, but she was very nervous. She was fidgety. She was reading the paper on the plane. And I'm going like, okay, who reads the paper on the plane? Like the, you know, how do you fly and how to tuck your head and all that stuff, you know? And I'm like, what is going on? And finally she looked at me. She said, I'm sorry. I just took a new job and this is my first flight. And I'm like, oh, this is going to be good. I said, well, ma'am, let me just tell you, planes are a lot safer in the air than they are on the ground. I'm trying to encourage her. I'm giving her all that this thing was made to fly and all this. And I think I might have helped a little bit. But can I tell you, she was worried. Well, we took off, and I kind of laid my head back for a minute, and then all of a sudden we hit turbulence. Now, if you've never been in a plane in turbulence, that'll check your prayer life right there, especially if they're mean turbulence. I'm not talking like little blips. I'm not talking about those. I'm talking about when your body comes out of the seat and you go back down, and she looks at me and she goes, what's happening? I said, it's okay. We're in rough air. Oh, it got worse. She finally looked at me, and she had asked me before we took off. She says, what do you do? I said, well, ma'am, I'm a pastor, and I coach leaders all over the world. And she goes, oh, okay. And all of a sudden, when this plane starts bouncing more, she looks at me and goes, what are you going to do? I said, what do you mean, what am I going to do? She said, you're a preacher. Do whatever preachers do. So I got up and took an offering. I mean, it was amazing. But have you ever been in a situation where if you've never been there before, you can get worried? Do you know what I'm talking about? And now I got to tell you, everybody I know worries about different things. And some of you right now, you're going, oh my goodness, Tim, why do you have to talk about worry? Because can I tell you, even coming here today, it's a little different. It's different setting in church right now. It's a different world. Our economy, families are hurting. And it's easy to wonder and worry about the future. Some of you are wondering, what are my children's children going to have in the future? And I just want you to know that God is about to do something in this world, that he's going to announce to this world that I'm greater than any virus. I'm greater than any situation. And he's going to tell you, I never want you to walk in fear. I want you to walk in wisdom. Wisdom. Worry. Can I give you a myth? Can I give you a myth? Can I give you a myth? Somebody write in the text out there, yes, give me a myth, because right now we're quiet here. I don't know what the issue is. Can I give you a myth? Can I give you a myth? So here's the myth. Here's the myth. I'm sorry, my mic's got a gremlin in it. Here's the myth. Are you ready for the myth? I'm ready for the myth. Here it is. Are you ready? I can control things by worrying about it. That's a myth. The truth of it is worry does nothing for you and I. Now, I'm preaching to PT right now, okay? Worry does nothing for you except make you miserable. Make you miserable. What did Jesus say about worry? In Matthew, the sixth chapter, verses 25 through 34, God weighs in and he gives us five things that he says worry will do to your life and why it doesn't work. Worry is a failed strategy. If you came today, I want you to let you know, I'm not going to leave you in the broken place. I'm going to take you to the place where I can defeat worry in our lives. You want to go there with me? So let's first talk about what worry will do to us. Number one, worry is unreasonable. In verse 25, he says, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food and body and more important than clothes? What God is saying here, he's not yelling at us. He's saying, hey, you got to get your perspective right. You're worried about things that I'm not even one bit concerned about. Because my God shall supply all of my need according to his riches in Christ Jesus. He's saying it does not make sense to worry about anything in life, unimportant or important. Would you agree with me that we tend to worry about material things? We tend to worry about food and water and paychecks. Would you agree with me that we tend to worry about our children, those of us that have children? If we're single, we tend to worry about the future. Oh my goodness, what's this person going to be like? Right? If we've ever gone through the pain of a horrible separation, we worry, will I ever go through that pain again? It's very unreasonable. It's unreasonable because God wants us not to worry about this present place. He doesn't want us worrying about anything, but it gets unreasonable because we tend to worry about the externals instead of thinking about the internals. So, if you worry about something that you can't change, God is saying to you and I, don't do it. Don't do it. And I just want to tell you at the beginning of this, and we'll come back to this, God will never ask you to do anything that he will not give you the power to do it. Okay? So, I'm not going to be shouty today, but I want to equip you because I don't know about you, but I got some friends right now that are worried. I've had some days in my life that I've been concerned. Over these last few days, I've walked out and I've led with, faith and hope and vision. But man, there have been days I'm going, Lord, I got friends that are really hurting. The second thing is worry is unnatural. The Bible says, look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? And then he moves from the birds and he says, let me tell you about flowers. You see how beautiful flowers are? Look on the fields, the lilies. Look at these flowers. They don't worry about anything. Isn't it amazing that God cares about the birds, God cares about the flowers, and we're worried, is he caring about me? Does he know I'm hurting? Is he aware that's going on? Does he know what's going on in my marriage? Does he know what's going on with my children? Does he know what's going on in my job? Does God know? Yes, he knows. And he's up to something good. And if it's not good, he ain't done. I'm telling you right now, he is for you. His favor is on you. I just want you to be encouraged today. Can you tell that? Worry about these birds. My wife and I walk every morning and we watch the birds. And she's always nervous because the hawks dive down. And I'm thinking about, honey, I'm going to karate chop him. I'm like, I'm going to get the bird. I'm going to protect my wife. I'm a good husband. Going for the husband of the year. Hawk, be gone. Anyhow, I'm ready. And here God is watching the welfare of these birds. And you and I are worried. I got to tell you. They don't do a lot except build nest. And yet God cares about them. Look at the flowers. The Bible says in Psalms 145, verse 16. That God satisfies the desires of every living thing. If he cares about the sparrow that flies, then he cares about you. He cares about you. It's good news. It's good news. You can tell everybody around you, God cares about what's going on in my life right now. The things that are in my life right now that you worry about, that paralyze you. Have you ever been gripped by so much worry and fear, you're just paralyzed, you can't think? Have you got that phone call? Have you had that person talk to you? Have you had your son or your daughter or your spouse get into a place, your coworker, where you're going, oh Lord, please be with them? Let me just tell you this. The devastation that worry is having on our lives is overwhelming. The stomach problems, the headaches, the stress. One man told me not very long ago, Tim, I'm worried sick. And he's right. He's right. I just want you to know that your Heavenly Father, please hear me right now. Your Heavenly Father knows what you have need of. And he right now is lining it up to make sure that your needs are met. They're met. They're met. The third thing is it's unhelpful. It brings no value. It doesn't help. Worry does not help. Somebody needs to hear that this morning. It's not only unreasonable, it's not only unnatural, it's unhelpful. Worry does not help anything. It does not change anything. It only makes you more miserable. Anybody in the room besides me ever got worried because you were worried? No, I'm serious. Anybody in the room besides me ever got worried that you weren't worried? No, I'm serious. I've been like, man, I should be worried right now. As a matter of fact, I've had some situations in the last couple months that I'm going, I should be worried right now, and I'm not worried. I told my wife this week, I said, honey, why do I have so much peace about this? I'm trying to check it out. I'm going, something's wrong with me. I should be worried right now. And then I've had days in my life that I got to thinking about something and I got to thinking about something. Do you understand this word stew? I started stewing about it. I started going, oh. And before long, I'm like, now I'm worried that I'm worried. And I'm like, man, this ain't right. But what do people worry about? Well, they worry about their past. If they don't worry about their past, they worry about the future. And if they don't worry about the future, they worry about right now. Worry. It doesn't change anything. It is the most worthless thing you and I could ever do to spend our energy and our focus on. I love you. My name is PT, Pastor Tim. What are you worried about? What am I worried about? To say we're not worried, I don't believe we'd be honest. I think we have been worried. I think right now some of us are worried. Not only is it unhelpful, but the fourth thing is it's unnecessary. Can I tell you? In verse 30 in chapter 6, here's what he says. And if God cares so wonderfully for the flowers that are here today and gone tomorrow, won't he much more and surely care for you? And then he follows up with this statement, oh, ye of little faith. I'm like, thank you. That's like, hey, buddy. And sometimes we need God to shake us, to wake us up, to go, why are you listening to the fear and the worry of this world when I've called you to dominate and called you to walk by faith and not by sight? It's unnecessary. He says, I'm your heavenly Father. You don't have anything to worry about. I can tell you God knows where your next paycheck is coming from. God right now says, give and it shall be given unto you. Press down, it'll be given back to you with good measure, and it will come from men and women around you. Can I tell you what I believe? I'm speaking over your life right now. And this time, God's going to give you a promotion. God's going to raise you up and elevate you. Your sales are going to be higher than ever before. Your recruiting's going to go through the roof. Every good thing he's waiting to give you right now. I just want you to know it's unnecessary. We walk by faith and not by sight. Can I tell you, I don't like that. I don't like it. I'm a pastor and I don't like it. Because I want to see it. I want to be able to hold it. And he's going, no, touch me. Trust me. Believe me. Believe Philippians 4:19. My God, my daddy, shall supply all of my need according to his riches in Christ Jesus. Does God care about your car payment? Yes, he does. Does God care about your mortgage payment? Yes, he does. Does God care about your doctor bills? Yes, he does. Does God care about your relationships and your dreams and your hopes and your goals and your visions? Yes, he does. God cares and he's got his eye on you. The fifth one I don't want to tell you, but I got to. Worry is unchristian. I know it hurt, but I had to write it down. It's acting like God does not exist. It actually, man, I get convicted because God's going, when did you turn into an atheist? I'm like, well, thank you very much. It's acting like God does not exist. Worry is just simply saying, God, I don't believe you. Now listen, I don't want to say this, but I'm going to. Non-believers have a right to worry. If you don't know him, you have a reason to worry. Because if you're separated from God, you're separated from the source. You're separated from every good and perfect gift that comes from the Father above. One of the things that I always wanted my children to know, I never wanted to spoil them, but I wanted them to know their needs were going to be met. I think that's the heart of the Father. God says, I'll never be too concerned about your greed, but I will be concerned about your need. But I was praying that my children would never be nervous to me and say, Daddy, I need this. As a father, one of the greatest joys of my life is for my kids to come and say, Daddy, can I get this? I'm humbled because my children don't ask for a lot. And because of that, it makes me want to bless them even more. Somehow, I think that's the heart of our Father. The Bible says, if you're faithful with little, I'll give you much. Some people want much, and they haven't been faithful. The world is looking for talent and gift, and God is looking for faithfulness. If you're faithful, he's going to make you able. That's why you can get around educated, highfalutin people who've got more degrees than a thermostat and a thermometer. And can I tell you something? They can't perform. Do you know why? They're not faithful. If you're faithful in the little, he says, I'll get you to the next spot. God says, you all are my children, and will you please stop acting like orphans? My wife and I have been blessed with two kids, Blake and Bree. You see Bree up here. You see Blake playing the drums. They're so gifted. But I have a lot of other people that we bring into our family that are like daughters and sons. And it's a great joy for me to be that person in other people's lives. The worst kind of worry, I believe, is not only are you worried about the things that are going to go wrong in your life, but some of us are even worried about the good. When God blesses us, we're immediately thinking, well, something's going to go wrong. Your marriage is going good and you're going, oh, but it's going to fall apart. Have you ever had these friends in your life that when something good happens in your life, they come along and go, oh, be careful though, because it's about to go south quick. I know it's good right now. Have you ever been walking in the blessing of God? See, I want to tell you, as your pastor, I deal with some of this. We needed miracles. We needed these lights up here. We needed new cameras. And it was a $12,000 bill. And can I tell you, I went out, stepped out on faith. And when I did, we ordered them. The enemy hissed at me, you big fool. Way to throw your ministry and your family and your church away. Way to do it. I had a little conversation with him. I said, listen here, Satan. God told me to do it. And if it's God's will, it's his bill. And I'm telling you right now, where he guides, he provides. And I did it because God asked me to do it. And I'm going to tell you the other reason I did it, because God's people are going to respond to it. And we're going to keep growing. Even in the midst of these down times, we are going to grow. I'm telling you right now, we're going to grow. Well, can I tell you? One man called me on a 2 to 3 days afterwards, and he goes, hey, I've been watching, and I want to write the check. My family wants to write for the check. And he was smart. He said, but let me ask my wife first. I went, ooh, that's a smart man right there. And they prayed about it. And they said, we want to be a part of sowing into reaching thousands and thousands. And in the worst of times, they believe God for the best of times. And he wrote the check. Well, after he wrote the check, we started hanging up these lights. I mean, all these lights are hanging up here. Church, can I just talk to you real and authentic? I mean, they're hanging up there. They're thousands of dollars, and I'm going, they don't even have a steering wheel on them. You can't drive it nowhere. You can't go get a pizza with it. I mean, all it is just to light me up, and all you can see is my imperfections. I do have to tell you, while we were worshiping, I was looking at my wife. She's a little thing that stands over here. And I went, man, she's got beautiful eyes. And I was just thanking God. I was going, God, thank you for my beautiful wife. Isn't that true? But man, we get worried. You know what we say? Things are too good. Things are too good. So what I want you to do right now, and I'm going to give you three things. We'll give you three things. Are you ready? But right now, I want to ask you a question. And if you can do it privately, I want you to write down, what is your greatest worry right now? What are you most concerned about right now? I pray that God will stop the noise of worry so we can hear him. God's been dealing with me. I may speak on anxiety next Sunday. Do you know why? Because I believe that worry creates such anxiety in all of our lives. So are you ready? I'm ready. If you're ready, say, I'm ready.
I'm ready.
Look at your neighbor and say, I'm more ready than you are. Look at your other neighbor and say, I am so glad he's talking to you right now. So here's the question, right? And for me, here's the question. Goad, that's real good. I'm really fired up, PT, that you're doing that. But can I tell you something? How do I stop it? How do I stop? How do I quit? What is the cure? What is the antidote? What is the vaccine? Number one, Number one, are you ready? These three things are going to change our lives if we put them in place. Number one, put God first in every area of your life. Put God first. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Seek His perspective. Seek His way. Seek it. It's one of the reasons that we worship. When you worship, do you know what happens? You're emptying yourself of you and you're filling yourself up with Him. And He's going to give you insight and wisdom and understanding. Put God first in every area of your life. Matthew 6, 32 and 33 says, your heavenly Father already knows. Please go in your Bible and underline that. He already knows perfectly well what you need, and He will give it to you if you give Him first place in your life. God is saying, if you will put me first in your life, I know every need you have. But a lot of people are going, God, I want to do it my way, and we want to turn God into a vending machine. I put in my prayer, I pull the lever, and you better drop down the answer, God. And if you don't, you're not God, and you're not a good God. No, He's saying there is some things you need to do. And number one, I need to be first in your life. Worship no other gods. Don't let any other idols come into your life. He's saying right here, give Him first place in your life. Worry is a warning light that we have mixed up, messed up values. Man, I don't like to preach to myself like this. Whenever I start worrying, it means something is out of whack. It means that something else has taken first place in my life. God is number one in your life, and He's going to become the source of your strength and your victory, and He will cause you to walk in peace that will almost mess you up. Here's your be going, I shouldn't have peace right now. It's a sign that you and I have surrendered our lives completely to Him. One of the commandments says this, thou shalt not have any other gods before me. Worry replaces God. God, forgive us. God, forgive me. God, forgive me. When we get our priorities in order, do you know what happens? And I'm going to move to the second one. When we get our priorities in order, it simplifies and clarifies our lives. Wow, that's big. Can I tell you? Put God first. Second thing, live one day at a time. Live one day at a time. Live one day at a time. In verse 34, he says, so don't worry about tomorrow because tomorrow will have its own worries. Each day has enough troubles of its own. Can I get an amen? Amen. How many of you agree with that verse that worrying about tomorrow is like opening an umbrella today because it's going to rain tomorrow? What are you doing? Oh, it's going to rain tomorrow. I'm worrying about tomorrow is opening the umbrella, and you got to go, no, I'm not going to do that. You and I get this privilege to trust Him. Will you do me a favor? I'm begging you. Will you please let go of your yesterdays? Will you stop talking to yourself about your failures and your mess-ups and your mistakes? Most of our lives, we can't do anything to fix yesterday, but we can create a brand new future. If any man or woman be in Christ, they are a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, brand new has come forth. Matthew 6, verse 66 says, give us today our daily bread. Give us today. Do you know what most of us are praying? God, give me my monthly bread. Give me my weekly bread. God, give me my yearly bread. God, give me my 10-year bread. And God is saying, no, I'm going to give you your bread today. The third thing is this. Trust God to care for the things that are beyond your control. Now, that's going to drive some of us crazy that are control freaks. You type A's out there, I love you. I am one of them. I get it. If you don't know if you're a type A or not, go to some place where there's an elevator, push the button, and if the door doesn't immediately open, you'll punch it 5 more times. You're a type A. Put God in every area of your life, one day at a time. And I just want you to know this, that worry and trust cannot live in the same place. So what I believe God wants you to do is Philippians 4, 6, and 7. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God your need. If you do this, you will experience God's peace, which is far more wonderful than the human mind can understand. Can I just give you this? Don't panic. Pray. Pray. And I want to encourage you, even though the noise of worry is so loud, the static is so loud, you feel like you're out of range. It's a mess. I want you to start, if you can't pray, begin, just start by praising. God, I worship you. I thank you that you're on the throne. You're going to take care of us. God, I thank you that you are going to supply the need that I have in my life. Put him first in your life. Trust God for things that are beyond your control and live one day at a time. When I was a little boy, we used to go to church and they used to sing this song. Matter of fact, I used to sing it and it was that I don't have to worry anymore. One day I'm going to get to heaven and I don't have to worry anymore. And we would sing that song and people would cry. And I used to honestly think, man, that's a great song. But I'm going like, no, we don't have to get to heaven not to worry. We can have heaven right now visit us. And we can stand. So Romans 8:32 in the Living Bible. And come on, praise team, let's do it. Worship team, let's do this. Romans 8:32. Because I want us to declare right now the favor of God. And I want us to break the power of worry in our lives right now. Romans 8:32 says, since God did not spare even his own son for us, but gave him up, won't he surely give us everything else? What is he saying? He's saying, if you can believe me for your salvation, you can trust me for your daily needs. If you can believe God for your eternity, you can believe God for today. God is going to move. There's a story in 2 Chronicles, verse 20, where Jehoshaphat, how many of you know you got to be anointed to be called Jehoshaphat? He's going into battle. And he's going into this battle, but God says to him, the battle is not yours. I want to say to somebody today that's been worried about your finances, you've been worried about your children, you've been worried, you've just let worry take over in your life. Can I tell you something I want to do today? I want you to understand that in these next few minutes, and I want you to declare, we're not going to be long, I want you to declare, come on online, declare with me, the battle is not mine. The Lord, I'm going to surrender my life to him, and I'm not going to be anxious with anything. Can I tell you, there are a lot of things that God tells us in his word to obey him on. The commandments, look at them. Don't lie, don't cheat, don't commit adultery. Can I tell you the hardest thing that I believe God asks you and I? Do not worry. Do not worry. I just want you to know that right now, the God of the universe, I'm not trying to be weird, I just want you to know he's alive. The God of the universe right now wants to, if you will invite him, he wants to break the back of that worry in your and my life. It takes the first step where I just need to say, Jesus, I need to be yours. I accept you as my Lord and Master and Savior. Matter of fact, right now maybe you're going, Tim, I need to know him. I need to surrender my life. I need to recommit my life to him. And I just want to let you know this little simple prayer, Romans 8 tells us, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us. He shed his blood on the cross. He came alive on the third day. He sits at the right hand of the Father, and he's praying for you. And you know what he's praying? God, release my power into their lives. and free them from the worry that has been tormenting them. Set them free. So would everybody just pray this prayer with me right now? Dear Jesus, I need you. I'm lost. I can't save myself. Please save me. I confess I'm a sinner. I accept your forgiveness. I am your child. In Jesus' name. Okay, will you stand with me right now? And we're going to finish. And I want you to declare before God. And I'm just going to pray for you right now. Will you let me pray for you? Will you get in agreement with me right now? And while I'm praying for you, will you pray for me? Come on, we need to pray for one another. Come on, we need it. And I encourage you to find somebody who walks in faith today that you can confess to them, hey, I've got a concern. I've got something that has been on my heart. And Tim, I want to release it. I want to trust God. Listen, I'm not saying don't walk in wisdom. I'm not saying that. We're going to walk in wisdom. The Bible says, be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. We're going to walk in his wisdom and understanding and power. God's going to give us insights and thoughts and ways. You watch. God's at work. He's got an answer for whatever it is you're facing. So right now I'm going to pray for you, and then we're going to worship. And I want you to declare with me, okay? I want you to take this moment to fight in worship. Worship is a weapon. You can destroy the power of hell in your life with worship. I promise you, you can break that spirit of fear that's trying to intimidate you. And God did not give you a spirit of fear, but of love and a power and of a sound mind. And you need to declare that. Will you do that? All right, here we go. So Lord, I thank you that I can come to you in the name of Jesus, the name that's above every other name. Right now, we call on the name of Jesus to break the back of worry and fear in our lives. And we release right now the spirit of peace and the spirit of joy. And God, we are going to guard our hearts. And we're going to guard our souls. And we're going to guard our minds with your word and with your power. And we're going to do these three crazy little steps. We're going to make you number one. We're going to make you the priority, God. We're going to trust you one day at a time. We're going to believe you, God, over the noise of this world. I speak peace. I speak power. I speak wisdom. I speak renewed minds in the mighty name of Jesus. And we give you praise and glory and honor in Jesus' name. Now, I want you to seal it right now. I want you to seal it with the praise of your lips. Are you ready? Come on, church, let's do it.
May your favor be upon you and 1,000 generations and your family and your children and their children and their children.
Children and their children.
with your presence, oh, with your name, Jesus. We seal it with amen. We seal it with amen. That means we declare it. That means we receive it. Amen, amen, amen. Amen, 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 amen. Amen. Jesus, this morning we just want to seal what you've spoken over us. God, we want to seal it with an agreement that we believe it's going to happen in Jesus' name. God, we want to stand in unity with you, in full agreement of what you can do. So as a church, as a family, as a body, God, we seal it this morning. We say this in Jesus' name. Amen. Can you say amen? Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Jesus. So good. Are you happy to be back, G5? We ain't going nowhere. We are here to stay in Jesus' name. We're going to be here Tuesday night, which is going to be awesome. It's the original service. I love it. We have two best days of the week here at G5. It's Sundays and Tuesdays. And so I hope you will come 7 o'clock on Tuesday nights. We gather right here. Just a little update. I know it's a little sad, but we are not doing food right now at G5. I know. But G5 still likes to do what? We like to eat. That has not changed. But we definitely are moving forward with that. We want to just be super considerate and use wisdom. If you think about it, food's just, that's a lot of cross-contamination. So we just want to make sure we're very, very just cautious with that. We may get eventually down the road to where we suggest that if you want to bring a personal cooler with your food in it, and you can just keep it in your car until church is over, and then you can have your own picnic with your food, but you can still sit with people you love, but you're going to be eating your food, nobody else's, okay? We may get to that point because that is a huge part of who we are, amen? And so we don't ever, ever want to stop that, but right now we just want to make sure we're keeping clean and safe. But I almost said I'm going to pray over the food, but I'm not going to do that either. I guess I'll pray over wherever you all going to get your food. I'll let you know. But also, we want you to do this. We want you to know that you don't have to leave. Like, this is kind of weird because usually we go out and eat, but you don't have to leave. We've just set it up out there for you guys can still hang and chill and be in community. So don't leave. If you want to leave, please do so. We're not going to force you to stay, but we would love for you to stay and just have community and fellowship with us. We haven't seen you in so long. We would just love to talk to you and chat. All your friends are here. We've missed you so much. So please do not feel like you are needing to leave. We would love for you to stay. We do have a connect tent right outside. So if you do want to connect a little bit with our team, there's connect cards there. There's decision cards. If you gave your life to Jesus this morning, you can fill out a card. We would love to connect with you. If you did give your life to Jesus this morning, I usually have the book and it's not, that's okay, I'll get it. But there's a book that says Your New Life, and we would love to give this book to you today. So if you want to head on out to the connect tent, you can find it there. We do ask that you guys keep your hands clean today. There's lots of sinks and hand sanitizer everywhere. The donation is in the back, so if you're on your way out, you can drop it there. You want me to talk about Elevate? That's what you said. It is. Guys, Elevate is coming up. 4 weeks. 4 weeks. So it's June. Oh, we got to change that. Ooh, ooh. Elevate already happened. Okay, so let's take that away. Elevate is June 26th. Yeah! Elevate is June 26th through the 28th. It's going to be so special. You know, we believe that this is actually probably going to be one of the most powerful conferences we've ever had, because we believe that everyone is going to be just super grateful and super open-hearted to what is going to happen at this place, because we've been away from each other for so long. And so I'm believing, and we are agreeing, that Jesus is going to do something powerful with this conference. If you don't know what it is, it's our ultimate leadership conference. We get all types of questions. Well, is it just for church leaders? Do you have to be in a church? No, we promise any leader. We say this at G5, but if you're breathing, you're a leader. And so we would love for you to come, whether you work a 9-to-5, whether you're a mom, whether you're a dad, whether you cut hair, whether you, I don't know, how many thankful that there's haircut places starting to open back up. Woo! Thank you, Lord. Amen. But just no matter your walk of life, this is something for you. We say this all the time, but what we love about this conference is we don't really just kind of focus on what you do, but we really want to focus on who you are, because who you are determines what you do. And so come check it out. The tickets are still on the app. They're on the website as well. We would love to see you. Come and hang with us. It's going to be right here, so it's going to be great. There is going to be food at Elevate. Mama G is cooking at Elevate, and you get to eat it there, okay? So make sure you come on out. But, oh, we had new apparel. Oh, my goodness, I totally forgot. Can you come down here, actually, because you look good. You look good. Come here. Come here, son. Brother. Son. You look good. Okay, let's see it. Okay, so this is our new shirt. Oh, yeah, get the sleeve. So it says G5 Church. Whoa, okay. Yeah. G5 Church. And then turn around. Let's see it. Hope Dealer. How cool. Okay. Thank you. Does anybody have our other shirt on in the house? Social distancing, does anybody? Ooh, that means you're going to have to go get one. But our other shirt says social distancing, and there's a line in the middle of that, and it says there's no distance with God. And then on the back, it has the G5 fist pump, and it says G5 Church, because we're all about our fist pumps at G5. But we made this just this summer collection for you guys, because we believe that as G5ers, we're called to be hope dealers. And how cool that we got to be a hope dealer in the midst of this season that we were in. And every season, we believe that hope is never lost. It's always there, and hope happens here. Amen. And so make sure you check out the new G5 gear. It's out there. You can check it out. Mom's so excited about her kids' shirts. They are. For the babies, it's going to say cutest G5er. It's so cute. I know. Aw. It's really cool. They got to wait and see those, though. That's right. But they're coming, I promise. What I'm going to do, though, I feel weird without praying. So if it's okay, I'm going to seal just a prayer on everybody. I know we've prayed a lot today, but there is nothing wrong with praying a lot. Amen. It's a way of living. And so then we can be released and everybody can go hang out. So Jesus, we just thank you for today. God, we thank you for giving us this opportunity that we got to come together and we got to worship and learn about you. God, I thank you for healing. I thank you for healing our land right now, God. God, I just believe that you are just completely just getting rid of the fear and the worry. God, in every country. It's not just here. It's in every country, God. So I thank you for who you are. I thank you for what you stand for in our lives, God. You are full of peace, full of joy. I thank you for every life in this room. Again, God, I'm just so grateful that we got to come together today. I hope we never, ever, ever take it for granted that we get to come together. We get to lift your name, God. So I ask that you just bless us and put your favor on us, Jesus. We give you all the honor, all the glory in G5, in Jesus' name, and G5 said, amen. I love you, G5. Go have an amazing day. Go hang out. I love you.